Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Thank you for coming to our panel on Network Publics. For this panel, I really want to invite the panelists and also everyone in this room to really be thinking pretty broadly about having really big dreams when we're thinking about technologies and the new affordance that social media tools can play in fostering global well-being. A lot of you know Bill Gates. I think of him as a pretty good role model for people here at Microsoft. Globally, he left Microsoft to found the Bill and Gates Melinda Foundation. And in 2014, they set this very broad aspirational goal that we could conceivably end world poverty by 2035. And one of the things that I really liked about this this letter that he wrote as a part of this statement of aspiration is that we have a lot of reason to hope, actually, if you look historically at poverty levels around the globe over the past 40 years, there's actually been a pretty substantial shift. When we think about global well-being, however, I think it's important to think not just in terms of economic success or economic well-being, but also in terms of quality of life. And there's been a really interesting movement in the more government circles recently about redefining or reconceptualizing what does it mean to be high in prosperity, not just in terms of economic well-being, but also more subjective factors such as that you are meaningfully connecting with your people, your relationships, your work, you have meaning in the quality of your work, and that you also are participating in a thriving community. And in fact, this graph shows that, you know, once you get out of the sort of the once you get out of the poverty level as a society, your the relationship between well-being and economic levels goes it plateaus out. And doing a review online of all the potential sources of low well-being, there's actually quite a lot of factors out there, such as overpopulation or unequal distribution of resources, inadequate education and employment. And these are all variables that we can attack through the use of technology. And I actually think that we're in a, sort of an exciting time where a lot of the emerging trends in technology are giving us a lot of new opportunities for addressing a lot of these global issues that are preventing well-being. For example, learning networks where free and open learning is being available more globally. A lot of the conversations that we've been having in the past couple of days around crowdsourcing and crowdfunding actually are providing these economic opportunities to disadvantaged individuals who didn't used to have these opportunities. Desni Tan mentioned yesterday that if you want to improve something, you also need to know, you have to measure it, be able to measure it so you know when you're improving it. And so we have, through a lot of analysis tools, ways to actually measure well-being, which are also pretty exciting for me as a data analytics person, and I'm sure there's a lot of people here as well. But for today, we're really going to be talking more about our social media tools and the role that they can play in empowering citizens. There's this we've all observed there's been a great transformation in how people are participating in the public discourse through social media tools. It's empowering citizens to find each other and cohere around common interests and then work together towards their common or collective social goals. And so when we're thinking about social media as a vehicle for increasing engagement, I really wanted to frame the conversation in terms of networked publics as third places, drawing from Ray Oldenburg, who wrote this great book, The Great Good Place, which has a lot of influence on my thinking and has really been influential in the thinking of most people who are engaged in community engagement or community technologies. Thinking about the third place is a place that's outside of the home and it's outside of the work where conversation occurs. It's where citizens or communities find each other and they develop and they begin to cohere, as I mentioned, around their desire to achieve collective action. And so it has a lot of power for this more sort of bottoms-up enablement of communities to help solve their own problems. network publics, because they've been increasingly ubiquitous, they're increasingly open and increasingly global, have actually are beginning to have a really meaningful impact in the way that citizens get things done together. And so today, I really wanted to thinking about this as an opportunity space. There are a lot of really dominant technologies in the first and the second places. We have Facebook, for example. It's really been optimized for connecting with people that you know, your friends and your family. You have technologies like LinkedIn and Office 365, which are really more optimized for the work environment. But there really isn't a technology that dominates the space for this more public sphere or third place. And we have, you know, if anything, the most dominant technology is still the mailing list. That's something that we were talking about last night, is that there is not, there's a lot of opportunities for innovation. We're thinking about how can we leverage these new kinds of technologies for community engagement or collective action towards common social goods. And so in inviting the panelists here today, I really wanted to frame the conversation around how can we leverage these new affordances in public networks towards increasing civic engagement and community well-being. They've done a lot of work in this space, and so what are some key lessons learned from their own work? What can be accelerating, and more importantly also, what are the blocks or barriers that are inhibiting progress that we should be designing for overcoming? And then also, what are the important next steps in the field? So the way that we're going to structure this is each of our panelists will be speaking for about 10 minutes. And then we're going to have them come up here and engage in conversation when we're thinking about designing these technologies for increasing global well-being. So we'll start with John Carroll. John Carroll is a distinguished professor from the Information Sciences and Technology at the Pennsylvania State University. He's actually done a lot of great work over the years in community and neighborhood informatics. That'll be really relevant for this conversation. So you all set up? Okay.
Thank you. Am I part of the same deck?
No.
So the am I being amplified? I can't tell. So the place of third places is the community, the neighborhood. And what I want to talk about is I want to make 4 points in my 10 minutes, or address four points. Despite the perennial risk of lost community, or we've lost it somewhere, I think community's rising again, and that the computing community has actually a long history of supporting innovation in community, and I think new opportunities abound. And basically what I want to emphasize, and this is the disruptive part, is innovation, not just well-being, beyond well-being. So community is, of course, a way to gain social support, build social capital, create solidarity, but it can be more. Okay, so this is the lost part. Community is in conflict with mass society, and we perennially see it slipping away. A lot of people think this is a point or an argument that goes back to Robert Putnam's famous characterization of how modern people are in North America are bowling alone. But in fact, it goes back to the definition of community 150 years ago. So the way I think of this is community is a little bit like love, and it is changing, and we're always afraid we won't get enough of it. But it's still there. Now, community is rising in that there are, I think, a lot of opportunities at the local level. So in my view, municipal governments have a renewed interest in democracy that I didn't see 20 years ago. Part of this is new tools like peak democracy, and even Facebook. And I think that increasingly municipal governments are really, they're afraid, but they're letting the genie of democracy out of the bottle. And as Keith was suggesting earlier, you know, vigorous discussion is a dangerous thing, but it's important to let it out of the bottle. And some of that is adoption of existing innovative methods like time banking and volunteering. Of course, these have been around for a long time, but their growth rates in recent years are very high. The Red Cross has seen growth rates up to 300% over the past 5 years of volunteering in some countries. And also new models of local innovation for delivery of social services, such as co-production, where people do things to help themselves. And then finally, new grassroots sorts of innovation like local foods movements, co-spaces, co-labs for various kinds of causes. Computer-supported community innovation is not a new idea. In North America in 1973, the Berkeley Community Memory was the first community network. That's more than 40 years ago. Andrea Kavanaugh, who will speak later, and I worked on the Blacksburg Electronic Village. That was more than 20 years ago. And these were highly innovative computing infrastructures at the time. But the transformative possibilities, of course, always change all the time, and I'll talk quickly about four. One is recruiting mobility and location, of course, has been mentioned earlier in this meeting. But an app that we created called Lost State College is an example of the kind of advantage you can gain now. Citizens walking around in a space can access and contribute to the construction of the history of that location using this app. And they can do this in interstitial time when they're walking around in the town. They wouldn't be doing anything else anyway. So it's not actually affecting the zero sum of people's time and attention. It just gives them an opportunity to know more and also say more about the heritage of their community and participate in that as an active endeavor. Another example is service aggregation. We created the Civicinity service that aggregated 50 local news feeds and 20 local calendars to give an aggregate and rich sense of activity and content at the local level. Another app, Local News Chatter, correlates local news feeds like local newspaper with tweets from local accounts so that in one view on your phone you can see a local news story and also what your neighbors are saying about that topic. These are correlated by term occurrence in the two sources. Alternative currencies, things like local currencies, of which there are thousands around the world now, time banks, also thousands. We heard about peer-to-peer collaborative micro-enterprises in a couple talks yesterday. These are all basically local innovations. They're indexed to a local community. Cryptocurrencies are not. But all four of these new currency paradigms have in common that they remove the mediation of national and global actors. So they undermine the hegemony of national governments, large corporations, and banks in economic exchange at a variety of scales. And then finally, these pieces can be put together with other pieces, such as reputation services for endorsing people in a LinkedIn style to get a sense of participation in the local community and to engage in, this should say geo-deliberation, although I like geo-liberation, processes of deliberation to identify issues in the local community and to work on those systematically. Crowdfunding is usually thought of a money-based enterprise, but in the local idiom, using sweat equity as in a time bank is probably more effective, and it's certainly a more serious commitment. Okay, so I think I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
So next up, we have Ed Cutrell, who's with us here at Microsoft Research, who's doing a lot of great work, him and his team, thinking about emerging markets, in particular in India.
Thanks, Shelley. I'm assuming it sounds amplified. All right, cool. So for those of you who don't know me, as Shelley said, my name is Ed Cutrell, and I manage the Technology for Emerging Markets group in Bangalore. And so I've been living in Bangalore for about 5 years now. And our group is basically a multidisciplinary group trying to understand how technology can be used by and on behalf of a lot of people that get ignored in a lot of technical innovation kind of work. And these are people that are typically very poor, living in the fringes of society in very large numbers in India, Africa, Latin America, other places. And the group itself is a very multidisciplinary group. And so I want to give you this just to give you some background that'll explain a little bit about where I'm going and what I'm going to talk about today. The group really tries to understand this mix between technology and people by taking the multidisciplinary notions of comms, ethnography, linguistics, design, HCI, and technology, and try to pull all those ideas together to create some really interesting kinds of studies and innovations. So what I'm going to talk about today is specifically this project called CGNet Swara, and then what has happened as a result of this project and where we're going forward on this. And I'll try to be pretty quick. This could be a very long talk, and I'll spare you that, and just try to push this into 10 minutes. So this is principally by a fellow named Bill Teese, who's in our group, and then a number of other people in the group, and including CGNet, MIT, and the International Center for Journalists. There was actually recently a story on part of this project in National Geographic, which I would suggest you look at if you get interested in this. It's much prettier than what I have to show you here. So the bottom line is that voice is still a critical piece in India and in the developing world. It is the main way of communication. But this actually leads us to some interesting problems. So of all of India right now, about a third of the population is non-literate. Okay? Now, about a quarter is literate in English. And that means about half of the population in India are literate in some other language. But this is how that breakdown of the other languages. You can understand how this actually starts to create some real issues whenever we're talking about typed text-based interactions of various sorts. Language, or spoken language, turns out to be a really important way for all these communities to talk to each other. And in fact, IVRs, or interactive voice response systems, are becoming huge business in India right now. And in fact, you're seeing things like Facebook voice version, which is appearing in India. There are actually a number of these kinds of things that are starting to appear. So what I want to talk to you about is an experiment that we did, a system that we built in a place called Chhattisgarh. So Chhattisgarh is a fairly fraught area in central India. It's right there. It's the problem in Chhattisgarh is that there's a lot of tribals that are there that are getting often there's a lot of tribals that are on the fringe of society there, and then there's a lot of materials that are there that other people, natural resources, that are trying to be exploited. And this has led to some serious conflict there. And there are a lot of people without a voice in Chhattisgarh. And this has led to some terrorist action, this has led to issues with Maoist insurgencies and other kinds of things. So one of the interesting problems here is that this is a graph of the number of speakers in the millions of some small languages in India, in Chhattisgarh. So you can see Kwi, Kuruk, Gondi, and this is on the order of millions of people speaking it. Now what's really interesting is to look at the green bars, which is the number of news outlets in any of those languages. And you'll notice it's zero. So there are no ability for these people to talk to each other in their own language. The other problem here is that it's not legal to broadcast news over community radio in India. So the only news that you can have is actually by government radio. So what we did was we built a system called CGNet Swara. And essentially what it is it's a voice portal. It's just an IVR kind of system that hooks up to the web. People can call into the system on their phones. They're actually quite ubiquitous there. They can speak an issue that's going on. It gets posted online. A moderator here then reviews it, makes sure it's kosher, that it's actually a reasonable story, and then posts it to the web, and then the audio version shows up on the phone system so that people can then call in and listen to the story that's shown up. So it's both online and on a voice system. Now this is really important. The voice version is important because this is actually the community to talk to each other. How can they find out what's happening? The online version is important because this actually then brings a window from the outside world into the concerns and issues that are being brought up by the folks here. So this is of the uptake. You can see that we've actually got quite a bit. This is actually growing substantially. As of, I think, early this year, we had around almost 300,000 total calls. And you can see it's on the order of 500 a day. So we've got quite a bit of activity in the system. And this is just an example of the kind of one of the early stories that made a big splash on the system and that actually brought up quite a bit of uptake. Now this is kind of a tragic story. Essentially what happens is that there's a thing called NREGA. This is a scheme for the government to give money to people to keep them sort of in the villages and on the farms between periods when they're harvesting. So sort of guaranteed money for doing general low skill work, building roads, things like that. What happened here is that a kid, was very ill. He's in the hospital. And the father needs to pay for his services for an operation or something. And he hasn't been paid his due, his NREGA salary. So he's going around to all of the different authorities trying to get paid this stuff. And while he's out trying to get his money, the kid dies back in the hospital. Now, what happened next was what was really interesting. So it shows up on BBC in Hindi, and then on The Hindu, and then The Times of India. And lo and behold, a lot of people start paying attention to this. And in fact, the guy got his money, and a lot of other people got their money as well. And this created this feedback system where people actually believed in the system and they started reporting more events. More things are going on. These are grievances as well as other problems that are happening. But it turns out that it's not just about grievances like this. This reported malarial deaths in Chhattisgarh. And these are the official government figures. See, 2002 all the way to 2009, it's like maybe 10. Now these are laughably small. This is completely impossible that this is true because malaria is endemic in this area. But what happened after CGNet shows up is here, and you see this big spike. And we can't say that CGNet is the reason for this, but it's kind of an interesting correlation here, and it's basically because these people are now having a voice and are reporting this stuff happening, and you can't hide it anymore. So the last thing I want to tell you about in this little piece is that it became much more than just speech. I'm going to see if I can play this.
Namaste, 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 Nama
Okay, I'll leave that alone. That, you can get that on Spotify later if you're interested. But the main thing here is that people really want to do more than just complain. They want to sing, they want to share stories about their villages and stuff like that. And so we set up another system on the same basic idea that's just a place for songs and poems and jokes and stuff like that. And people really love it, and they've picked it up dramatically. And one of the reasons here in the research is to try to understand, can we use the moderation of the people in this space to do this? The final thing I want to, I'm going to skip this part because I don't really have time, but I want to talk about this. Now, this is particularly relevant for all you guys. Based on this system that we built, we wanted to create an open source system called IVR Junction that anybody can use to replicate something like this. We got all these calls from people in other NGOs, other places, researchers that wanted to do something like CGNet. And so what we did was we created something that is essentially a turnkey system. You just put it on a laptop and you have a little plug-in modem and you can create the same kind of system as well as a lot of other kinds of things to do with it. You can just go to ivrjunction.org if you want to play with it, if you want to use it with your students or something else, you have an idea. We would love to work with you on something like this. With IVR Junction, we've now had over 30,000 people. It's been picked up by the Broadcasting Board of Governors. They're the guys who do Voice of America, among other things. And this is the Republic of Somaliland, which is a non-officially recognized country, I think. But they have a parliament, and they've now used it on their system for communicating with the citizens of Somaliland. So I think I'm going to wrap it up there, but the final thing I just want to make you think about with this is the use of things like voice for these kinds of places. It's not just about Facebook and Twitter, things like that. There are other ways in which we can bring people together into community and mediated interaction. So thank you.
Thanks so much, Ed. Next up, we have Andrea Kavanaugh. Who's coming to us. She's a senior research scientist and associate director at the Interdisciplinary Research Center for Human-Centered Interaction at Virginia Tech. And she's, you know, like Jack, Carol has been really active in the community technology space for a number of years and has a really great bigger picture perspective as it's evolved.
Thank you. Yes, I've been looking at the questions about the impacts of the internet and community computing for a long time, and have done some of that work with Jack, as he mentioned, with Jack Carroll. And what I wanted to focus on today is the changes that may or may not be there that are related to social media specifically with regard to community involvement and kind of civic engagement, something that we've been looking at for a long time. When you think about, you know, people being involved in their communities and civic engagement in particular, there are well-established predictors of community involvement, whether there is any internet involved or not. And for a long time, you know, we've known that education and socioeconomic status generally is in fact the biggest predictor of civic engagement. We were interested in whether the internet, in using the internet, would kind of make a difference in this kind of structural pattern, if you will, where there's a little bit of an elite that seems to always be out and involved, and you know, then there's kind of this silent majority. So Other predictors that have been in the literature for a long time include extroversion, being more obviously sociable and outgoing, having membership in multiple organizations and so on. This you know, general idea of activism, where you're interested in what's going on and you tend to take an interest. And those are also highly associated with opinion leadership, right? And the idea of life cycle stage, so, you know, where are you relative to, you know, having a family and children and being interested in the school system and whether there's playgrounds and so on. There's sort of a rising level of involvement as you are more concerned about the safety of your home or your you know, children and so on. So, you know, these are some of the known predictors, and yet there are other kind of intermediating variables, constructs that predict, you know, being involved in the community, this idea of keeping up with what's going on and belonging to groups. As Keith Hampton was talking about this morning, being interested in talking about what's going on, talking to friends and family, but also talking with people outside your home and people who have different points of view from you or have less knowledge or more knowledge, kind of heterogeneity in your discussion network. And that pointing to how people then might use the internet or social media to get more involved in the community. And so we really focused, you know, so everything I talked about so far has been established with or without the internet, right? So what, you know, role does the internet play above and beyond that? And we were especially interested in this comparison of social media as opposed to what we're calling, and the Pew studies that Keith was referring to earlier, studies, traditional internet, specifically email and web browsing, as compared with, you know, using social media such as social network sites and, you know, blogs, microblogs, file sharing, photo sharing kinds of applications and programs, using these specifically for civic purposes, right? So do you use email and web browsing to find local information, to stay informed about, you know, local or national news, post information, participate in sort of public discussion forums? On the social media side, obviously you are exchanging information among your social networks in Facebook and sharing information with people you know. And this is a more natural way that people do have political discussions, right? In their social networks, even knowing that they disagree with Uncle Harry at Thanksgiving, they still know who Uncle Harry is and whether or not to discount what he says. So the social media is a kind of a special case in that it's embedded in the, or reflecting, if you will, one's existing social networks, including those networks that arise from belonging to groups and voluntary associations, your church and, you know, your kids' soccer team or whatever. So we were testing empirically using statistical survey research over a long time. I'm going to tell you about specifically the differences with social media, because we have tested traditional internet for many years. And so the dependent variable in this case, we're trying to understand whether the internet, email and web browsing specifically, has made users feel that they have become more involved in local issues that interest them, local community generally, attachment to people or connections to people like themselves and diverse from themselves. And when we ask specifically about the social media, these are literally the wording in the questionnaires, the household surveys we administered in the past year. and ask them to think in, you know, comparing specifically with traditional internet, email and web browsing, you know, how much do you agree with the statement that social media, Facebook, Google Plus, and so on, has helped me become more involved in local issues that interest me? So just to, you know, pay tribute to correlations, what we did was to run a series of regressions and develop a path model that would test, you know, these kind of external variables, mediating variables, impact on the dependent variables. But the correlations are also very important. And what I specifically wanted to point out to you, if you look at education at the top, is this pointer working? There we go. You know, here's education as the first column, going down these different constructs that I was just mentioning. If you look at here is using the internet for civic purposes, education is very strongly correlated, right? But if you look at using social media for civic purposes, it's not a significant relationship at all. And here is, you know, the, you know, the impact of the traditional internet on getting more involved in the local community. Education is significantly correlated, right? You're better educated, you're more likely to be using the internet to, traditional internet, to become more involved. Social media, not at all, and in fact, well, you know, even though it's not significant, on top of which it's actually negative. So when we put these, and there's these correlations that appear across these are also important and interesting, which is why they're important to have in a model such as this, where you have it all of these variables put together that contribute to explaining the dependent variable over at the top right. Where's my up here? Can't get that far. Right under the word path is the dependent variable using the traditional internet, email, and web browsing to become more involved in the local community, is explained by all of these variables that come before it. Education is very important. Age squared, which is basically you get more involved as you reach middle age and declines as you get older and older. Extroversion, very important, right? So what's really significant here is the comparison with social media. So we look at the same model and the same variables. What has dropped out is the importance of education. Education is no longer significant in predicting using social media for civic purposes. And saying that, I shouldn't say that's at the bottom, at the top under the word model, the dependent variable, I'm more involved in the local community since using social media for civic purposes compared with traditional internet. So education and extroversion are no longer predictors here, which is the breakthrough that I was certainly looking for all these years when we've been testing what is the impact of the internet, thinking that, well, people will get more involved, but they weren't. It was still, as you saw in the previous model, education and extroversion, opinion leadership types of people were getting more involved. That's really not changing our overall involvement and participation. So social media really does present a kind of breakthrough in this pattern of civic engagement. So the upshot of that is that people are using their social networks and their, you know, what you expect sort of a natural way of talking with other people and sharing information and in their, you know, household and in their friendships and in their groups in the community. And the technology, the platforms and the tools need to accommodate that, you know, sharing and exchange where it is happening. So what commonly seems to be happening is that, you know, commercial providers see an opportunity to make a tool or a platform for civic engagement, and they force people to adapt to their platform, which makes it easy for the provider, but it's not easy to use. And so the problem for technology designers is to be able to integrate all of these diverse types of tools that people are using and aggregate them in such a way that you can discover these conversations that are going on and are perhaps more hidden and difficult to see, but they are there and they are accessible if the technology would do the work that it can, but it isn't always doing at this point. So that is all I wanted to say. Wanted to thank a couple of collaborators, and I want to again thank Jack for his involvement and our collaboration over the years on these themes, and Keith Hampton, who is an advisor on our current work. Thank you very much.
Hello. Okay, so our final presentation is from Bob Mason, who's here at the Information School, the University of Washington. Mason. they recently, or last, I don't know, 4 years ago maybe, started a social media lab where they've actually been exploring a lot of these issues and thinking about the broader scale social movements, which you'll be talking a little bit about today.
Thank you. Am I on? You can hear me? Good. Thank you. Thanks, Shelley, and thanks for having the opportunity to work with this panel. It's been very enlightening, and the whole summit has been great. Today I want to look at three things. I want to cover three things in my few minutes. I want to give you a context of where I'm coming from. There is someone said, and I don't remember who said this, but I think it's a great quote, that how one stands on where one sits. So I want to tell you where I'm sitting and what we've been doing at the lab and my team of collaborators, because they have influenced me. I will say a little about what we think we know. This is all work in progress, of course, but I will say what I think we know, some findings and observations. And I think we want to spend most of our time soon after I finish discussing what the opportunities are. And in my opinion, what I see, there's lots of research methods issues. We've heard from Mary Gray and others about the ethics. There is a proliferation of studies that without context data, which gives me some pause. And then the issue of design affordances for inclusion and realizing all the potential that we see with the technology and with social media generally. So the collaborators, it's a bunch. And I should say that all of these, I don't have Shelley on here, but on the next slide tomorrow I'll be having Shelley on, who's just joined us with some new studies. And it's not quite as broad as what you saw earlier, but we've got sociologists, we've got a geologist, we've got, of course, technicians. Jim Maddox there on the bottom is undergraduate. Kate Starbird is here this morning, and I should say that any one of these people could give you a more detailed and probably more nuanced view of what we're doing than I'm doing. I'm giving you an overview, and they may even argue with what I'm saying. But these are the great group I'm working with. In terms of context, 2.5 years ago, almost 3 years ago, we started by collecting data, looking at the Occupy movement. That was the motivation for starting this series of projects. And the question was, what should we look at first? As it turns out, Twitter turned out to be kind of a hub. And so we began to collect Twitter data. And as of today, last year, we stopped collecting after we had reached over 300 million tweets. We processed and used for our studies about 64 million tweets. When I say process, we put them in a form in a Mongo database that would allow us to do the analysis, the comparisons, and do some visualizations. The other part that we did, working with Kate, Kate had collected contemporaneously about 10.6 million tweets related to the Boston Marathon bombing. That was April 15th in 2013. We later got about 26 million tweets from GNIP. And I'll say a little about this later, but we thought that we were filling in the part that we had missed because there had been some equipment problems as Kate was collecting. So there were some holes in the data set that we collected contemporaneously. This bottom chart shows Kate started focusing on misinformation, false rumors. And you'll see several orders of magnitude. Yes, the crowd will try to correct misinformation, but it does it at an amplitude that's several order of magnitude lower than the false information that's propagated. What we think we know. There seems to be three roles of social media that are evident in what we've seen. First, there's an internal sense of community, sense of belonging. This is, I think, true of any social community, online or otherwise. It's a sense of belonging. There's an external or outward-facing role that, as you saw from the earlier presentation, it will get the attention of traditional media and amplify. And then there's the practical role of rapid communications, whether it's rapid responders for a crisis or whether it's an Occupy encampment that needs socks and suddenly they are overwhelmed with socks and so they send out a tweet saying no more socks, we've got plenty of socks or towels or whatever it happens to be. So there are those three roles and I think that's worth pursuing in kind of a general way. The other thing is place matters. We have a geographer. But it's not just geolocation that makes a difference. It's really a sense of place, which also associates with identity. So we saw tweets from the Boston Marathon bombing saying, "We are all Bostonians. You know, I went to school in Boston. I ran in the Boston Marathon once." There was a sense of belonging to that. But place matters. There's a high correlation in the Occupy Twitter set. Where people who are associated with a place communicated more frequently than those who didn't. And then influence. The idea of virality and memes propagate quickly, become part of the overall language, and as Ed has said, you know, they contribute to the social discourse, they become part of the agenda that we see. And it does this by there's a speed and a quickness, speed and reach of the social media that's unmatched by traditional media, it's, surprisingly, but then it's leveraged by what happens with traditional media. And then this is the disappointing part, and we're just starting to look at this. The dysfunctional behavior that we see in what is it called? As Shelley, not Shelley, you may have said it too, but you know, the real life, the window that's real life. What is the term that's called? In any case, the real life window. The same dysfunctions appear and may even be multiplied or amplified in social media. So social inequities. Gender hostility is what we're looking at right now. We've seen a lot of that. And so it's a little bit discouraging to see that being replicated or even amplified. Now, concerns and opportunities. So that's a concern. So it's now also an opportunity as a researcher. Now, we've heard several times, and I think we will just keep hearing it, we don't have the metaphors. We don't know quite how to talk about this whole new area. We talk about an ecosystem, an information ecosystem, a complex adaptive ecosystem. So that's a general metaphor. We talk about conversations. I've heard a lot today and earlier about a conversation that's made possible by social media. I'm not sure conversation quite covers it. We were looking at Goffman and the whole idea of dramaturgical approach and the presentation of self. And so sometimes it seems like instead of conversation, we're having performance art. People are just acting out, and we think that may be part of it. The idea of ethics in this space is we've heard a lot about that, and I think that goes back to the metaphors. How do we look at, how do we think about ethics when we don't have a metaphor? It's not necessarily a conversation. It's not necessarily performance. What is it? It's easy to collect data. That's why we see so many Twitter studies. It's easy just to scrape the data very quickly, but we're missing a lot of the metadata that may give the context, and so we may end up with misleading information. We're finding that there are some signatures, some behavior patterns, some retweet patterns, both in the Boston Marathon, the Occupy movement, that we want to pursue further. Any of you who are gamers, I think maybe that has an opportunity for helping us design spaces that are more inclusive and that dampen down dysfunctional behavior. Any of you familiar with League of Legends? League of Legends had a problem with a lot of trolling and dysfunctional behavior, and they finally hired a whole group of the whole game organization, hired about 30 psychologists, and they have been able to dampen down that as a kind of redesign. And so I see this as the opportunity, and I look forward to our discussions in the next few minutes. I'll acknowledge the Fuse Labs, the Information Society Center at UW, and NSF, a couple of awards that were helped us do this work. Thank you. You want us over here, Shelly?
Yeah, go ahead and come over here. I wanted to start with a couple of questions of our own, and then we'll open it up to questions for all of you to converse about these issues. I'll come over here. Is there going to be a microphone? Can we get another microphone?
I can just.
We'll just share.
We have to share
at
the
share.
End of the thing.
So the first question I wanted to ask, I was starting on a positive note, which is, what do you, sort of, in the context of this conversation, what do you find to be most exciting, or what are you most excited about when we're thinking about these new affordances for increasing community engagement or civic participation?
What's most exciting?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I would say that there's the infrastructure that's available for this. So I had a slightly different brief than some of the other people, of course. But for what I was talking about, which is supporting community innovation, I think that the infrastructure is available now, scaled down to community for the first time. They never did before. And I think that was basically an insuperable problem, because the cost proposition in community informatics is basically the infrastructures that you build out have to be close to free to work at all, because you're depending on totally on volunteer labor. But I think that has finally actually worked, even though it sounds impossible. it's very easy to put together these infrastructures now and appropriate things that work at societal scale locally, like Twitter, for example, which you know you've done too, and it is free.
Yeah.
So that's exciting.
Andrea?
Well, obviously, for me, I think the social media, as I was trying to say, is a breakthrough in the technology. Think, for example, also, I mean, here's a easy reference. Community groups in the past, I'm thinking geographic communities, right? So you have little community organizations, these voluntary organizations and so on, very important for community and social capital and diffusion of ideas and functionality in the community, solve problems. And they would have their listservs. And listservs are completely closed and private and password protected and so on. And you know that was fine. That helped them, you know, organize their communications between face-to-face meetings and so on. But now, for example, with a tool like Facebook, if they don't password protect their group, it's possible to collect the comments that they are making in their organization in an aggregator, and make that available as a set of comments to the rest of the community. So you're not going to just go track down these comments by yourself, but the technology can bring these to a level of attention that is not otherwise trivial. And so your organization is also interested in having more soccer fields, or they want more bike paths, or these are not big issues like Edward Snowden, but these are the issues that we live with in our lives on a community and daily basis. So they're small, but these are big breakthroughs for these kinds of ability to share and bridge ties across groups that previously was not easy to do.
So for the especially for a lot of the people that we work with and the spaces that we work with, I would say the most exciting thing is that in the space of maybe 15 years, you have literally hundreds of millions of people sort of being introduced into the great network of the 20th century, which is the PSTN telephone network. And very shortly thereafter, the great network of the 21st century of the internet. And this is just happening now. And so, you know, things like the CGNet Swara is sort of one way in which that's happening. But we're seeing it in a lot of different ways. And I think that's very exciting for a lot of these communities because they've really been quite isolated, much more so than a lot of other places on the planet. And this is, you know, in a very short period of time, we're seeing this injection into a larger set of concerns and thoughts and things like that. So I think it's both challenging and worrisome in some ways, but I think it's actually really very exciting.
Well, like the rest of you, I see the most exciting thing is the low cost of entry to try these things, so you're able to fail frequently and quickly and learn. So I think that's the big thing, is the range of experimentation that's afforded by this.
Well, and let's start the other way back. So thinking the opposite then, like what is the biggest barrier, or what is most preventing progress?
Well, right now it's very much on my mind, this whole idea of dysfunctional behavior and particularly gender hostility, which seems to be amplified by, I don't know whether it's the anonymity, I'm not sure what's causing this, but it's related to the whole idea of women are not able to, are not participating in the potential here that we see to the same extent that men are. It goes beyond women. It's kind of marginalized groups. So I think that's the biggest challenge we face, is either is both understanding that and creating design affordances that that get over that, dampen it, or in some way reduce it.
So I'm not really sure how to answer that. I think that maybe what I would say, again, I'm going to narrow it down into sort of a lot of the kind of work that we've been doing in these places, but there, one of the biggest concerns is language. And that as, you know, English becomes this massive hegemony and everything is developed for English with English. You know, you look at Wikipedia and it's almost all English, and then these smaller language communities coming down from it. And in a lot of these places, we have a real distinct problem with sort of having enough people that are speaking the languages that we're interested in that to maintain the kind of real community among them, and to join these broader communities and interactions, because it's basically these big dominant languages. It's Chinese and English, probably.
So I would suggest, for example, in the kinds of situations I was describing for geographic communities, having these kinds of integration tools and aggregating tools. One of the barriers for certain communities, and there are a lot of them, smaller towns, rural areas in particular, there aren't big market opportunities. There isn't an obvious way to make money, and so it doesn't attract some of the kinds of business solutions that you get for other problems that seem to be, well, the technology could do this. So, you know, you have some solutions like some of these aggregators for local content, such as Nextdoor and Everyblock and AOL's Patch and some things that have died and so on for various reasons. And as flawed as those are, they typically serve a larger population. So, and even those that are trying to serve sort of the smaller subsets, they may still be looking for large numbers of users. So, for example, even eDemocracy, you know, Steve Cliff's or group or his initiative, you know, getting local groups and so on to deliberate and get involved and so on. You know, you have to sign up 100 people before you're activated. And what happens then is that you wind up with the usual activists and the usual, you know, opinion leaders. And if you're trying to broaden participation and hear from diverse voices and serve, you know, all of not just America but other small towns around the world and so on, you know, we have to be able to find ways to leverage what the activity that is certainly there and discussion is happening and so on, to be able to integrate these difficult and knit together these difficult and diverse kinds of platforms and systems and devices and so on.
Well, I think the biggest challenge is in my context, is municipal planning. And people, I think this comes up in lots of other applications that we try to work on. People are just awful at planning. They don't like to plan, and they ignore plans. And what that does in municipal community context is it sets in motion a slippery slope toward community conflict, because people ignore the plan. They don't get engaged until the backhoes arrive or they're putting in the new pipeline or whatever, and then it's a community conflict. And we know from analyses in sociology of community from like 70 years ago that community conflict usually gets worse before it gets better. And so I've seen this, and although I think we've done a lot to enhance awareness really qualitatively, I think there's still a problem with planning, and I don't know if really municipal governments have to change to rely less on planning or how to make planning more engaging to citizens, but I think that's a major problem.
I wanted to add from my own work, I've
the two issues I think are really important. One is a lot of the systems that are out there are really optimized for personal networking or professional networking. They're not really optimized for this participation in public and civic discourse. And the identity management issues around that, for example, a lot of people are quite afraid, in fact, of participating in these public environments, women in particular, for they might get stalked or they don't want to overshare where they live, or, you know, and so these systems aren't really taking into account those concerns. And then another issue is while these tools are great for increasing conversation and participation and sharing, that translation from conversation to actually collective action, there seems to be a gap there. Like, how do we go from having this common expression that we care to actually working together effectively towards achieving our common goals? That's connects to these planning issues, I think. And so I wanted to, you know, sort of now that you've sort of gone through some of these questions, I wanted to open it up to the audience to have questions. And I saw in the back you had your hand up. So why don't we have a...
Keith in the morning talked about the trade-off between deliberation and participation, and I'm listening to Jack's comments about planning. I'm wondering, I mean, do you see that as necessarily a trade-off? And, you know, it would seem that the deliberation would be a part of planning, which would lead later to participation and collective action. What is the, you know, why does there seem to be a trade-off in, say, Keith's data, how might these technologies perhaps make those not trade off and reinforce each other?
Well, I could take a shot at that. I'm not sure if Keith is here. I think what he was calling, okay, what you were calling deliberation, I would not call deliberation. Mm-hmm. Because I think deliberation involves a more vigorous process of articulating. It involves a more vigorous process of articulating points of view and working towards consensus. If you don't do that, you're not deliberating. You're just arguing, or you know, you're just having a point of view. That's not the same thing. And so, I guess I do see participation as a less organized thing, a less focused thing, a less demanding thing than deliberation. But to me, that's the real difference. Now, deliberation is something humans also don't do. That's just very well known. I mean, when you want people to deliberate, you have to have a moderator or a facilitator, because they don't do that very well. They can learn to do it, but it's not a natural thing. And fighting is a natural thing. Conflict's a natural thing. Deliberation's not.
I'm sitting here by Keith, and I know he's got something to say to this too, but all of you have touched on a theme. This thought keeps emerging to me when Keith said that, talked about the deliberation versus participation, and then something that both Bob and Andrea said, I'm thinking, and when someone in the audience, I'm thinking maybe social media, particularly Facebook, isn't really about disruptive learning new things. It's about affirmation and associating with a group that you want to be part of, even because it's your avatar, it's the person you think you ought to be, or you know, it's the right place to be politically correctly. So maybe deliberation isn't happening because people aren't trying to learn new things. They're trying to affirm and group, you know, sort of associate. It's a different kind of activity that because it's not safe. It's not as safe as being in person where you can read people's signals, where you can say something and not have it misinterpreted, as could happen online. Just wondering what your thoughts to that are. I'm not so sure social media is helping the conversation. I think it's polarizing it.
Yeah, I'm interested in responding, and I'm sure others will too, because I was thinking about this when Keith was raising it this morning, and Pew does have a study that, you know, I know Keith knows about, that talks about the hesitation that people have to speak their opinions in Facebook that they think might be offensive to other people in their Facebook account. And so they, it's perfectly understandable, or it seems to me, you know, natural that, you know, you don't want to raise the conflict in that environment. You're going to be back there again tomorrow and next week and 6 months from now. And you want social capital too. So why would you foul this nest? It doesn't mean that you completely put a gag order on yourself, but you don't just, you know, unless you're someone who doesn't care, you know, you just put whatever you want up there, and we know people like that on our Facebook. And we also, I'm sure, most of us have people in there with diverse backgrounds. I certainly do. And I know I have people who are, you know, very diverse from me in there, and they're in there because they're like a high school pal. I have no idea really what their political, or I do know their political opinions now, and I, you know, I made friends with them, but I disagree with them, and I don't, that's okay. And the other thing, and you pointed to this, you write something down, you know, the moving hand writes and having writ moves on, and that's it. You can't, you know, very easily, or you have to go back and, you know, am I going to erase this or delete it, or, you know. So why clean up the mess? Just don't say anything. Let's go on to the next thing that somebody wrote in Facebook and see what's going on. So it, I think that, that people are moderate themselves, and they do that face-to-face as well, you know, at the dinner table or when Thanksgiving dinner or whatever. But that's not surprising that they're careful what they say with their social networks. I don't, but obviously I don't know either. I don't think that study has really been, those studies have really been done, and, you know, Keith is starting to get us there. So I'm really looking forward to the report when it comes out, but, you know, I think the, polarization isn't necessarily caused by social media, precisely because I, you know, for myself, and I'm pretty sure other people could, you know, agree or disagree, but, you know, I have very diverse people in my social, on Facebook, you know.
Dare I say, I disagree strongly.
Well, and I actually think this speaks to, when we're talking about public networks, because you are, in fact, projecting your voice in this public space, and you aren't necessarily aware of your audience as well, and so you're afraid, or you're less likely to have, express a deeper or more thoughtful opinion because of that. And so I think, you know, I was at a talk a while ago where someone brought up this issue of dark social, which is like there's a lot of social interactions that are happening that are outside of our view as researchers. And in fact, there is a lot of very, very deep and rich and intense conversations, but they're happening in these dark social places that we cannot observe or track through our research, in part because they are siloed. And you have a better sense of who the audience is. You know, and we were talking about this last night, that a lot of, in fact, the neighborhood or community interactions are happening in the context of mailing lists, in part for this reason. They are siloed, you know the audience, you know you more or less have agreement with that audience, and you're not as afraid to really express in a deeper way what your opinions are.
It's also the genre. You know, you said, when you asked your question, you said Facebook's for affirmation. You know, it is. It's not for deliberation. I mean, you'd be wasting your time to deliberate things in Facebook. And it isn't appropriate. People don't do it. What a surprise. But there are other things like peak democracy that's for deliberation. You know, so if your town has a peak democracy site, that's for citizens to discuss local issues. So
I go back.
We need more choices, I think.
Yeah.
You know, I go back to, I mean, this is, you know, an assertion. I don't have proof of it. But I think you're right. I think it will exaggerate the polarity for those who are not open-minded,
for those who are open-minded, it exposes them, as we heard from Keith this morning. They are much, the awareness is much broader. And so the network holes are filled through many of the social media. So, you know, I'm just asserting that it's an amplifier or leverage of what your natural inclination is going to be. If you want to deliberate things, social media is not the place for deliberation, but it is the place to identify people you might want to talk further with.
Any other questions?
Can I just add last point? Yeah. I mean, there's a work done by Eliyahu Katz and Paul Lazarsfeld back in the late 50s about, you know, how people are influenced in their behavior, that this sort of two-step model of influence, where you get messages from the mass media, or call it the internet, sort of broadly, you know, browser type of stuff, but so you get information, you're aware of something, but you may not actually adopt a new technology or change to Breck shampoo or whatever until someone that you know, some interpersonal contact, says, no, this is great, you know, I got this new phone, look at this, and so on. And that's where you really have the turning point. And so, you know, there's this combination of the awareness and then the social network influence.
Hi, I mean, this is for anybody on the panel, actually. I'm wondering what is sort of known to us about the extent to which you can, I mean, the discussion seemed to be that, you know, we've got social media, we've got sort of like, you know, these technologies, and I got this sense of sort of an isolation of the technology from the social context, not the economic context. I certainly see that, like, you know, certain sort of communities can only use voice and so on. But I mean, I'm just wondering if we know anything about, you know, the things that you can do independent of the technology to facilitate the kinds of sort of third space discussions or behaviors that you want to happen within the technologies. I mean, I think about examples sort of outside of the context of, you know, this discussion, but which involve the use of technology. I mean, there are examples from India, for example, of placing computers in sort of town squares and getting a local volunteer to sort of train people on how to use them as a way of sort of socializing the technology. You've got sort of similar examples from the last year in encouraging people to participate in farmers markets in France. I mean, like, you know, there's a theme there of sort of getting a local volunteer and sort of recognizing the sort of the social context in which you're layering on the technology. Mm-hmm. And so I'm wondering if in your research or in your investigations this connection has come up, and if so, sort of what have we learned? I mean, could it be that sort of the actual sort of details of the technology and the way that system is engineered don't really matter, and what we really should be focusing on is sort of the things external to the technology and facilitating the kinds of discussions that we want?
It's your turn. Sure. I'll take one pass at that, which is to say that you're absolutely right, in my view, that in most of the design that we work on and the stuff that we do is critically informed by the existing relationships in space and the way people are interacting with each other outside of technology. It's just they've got, you know, that's the space that people are in. And then you try to understand how technology of various sorts can be used to either amplify those things within that space that you want to amplify, or to overcome things that exist in that space that you're actually wanting to improve upon. But certainly, I mean, there's an example of this is not exactly what we're talking about here, but it's a good example of what you're talking about, which is using, say, mediators as means of, you know, say, spreading information. There's an NGO called Digital Green that tries to spread information around, it's basically farming, like smallholder farmers, and giving them extension information. And the understanding was that when you parachute in the professor from the local university, they listen, yes sir, that looks very good, sir. And then they go back, you know, we've been growing this stuff for 500 years. We don't need you to tell us how to do this. But when you bring in a local who's sort of a mediator, who then is able to talk about this in a more day-to-day basis, he lives there in the village, and then the video, then you show videos of people who are also local describing their experience using these techniques, the uptake of these things skyrockets, and you get about a 10x improvement in uptake of these kinds of practices. So that's an example of what you're saying there, which I believe exists in other things. We're investigating this now in actually using social media, where you have people who are very nervous about using the technologies, but yet there may be a point person that they can go to work with it, and to try to understand how do you design around that.
So I would disagree a little bit with the way you framed it. I think asking what's the technology independent part that you could work on with that, I don't think that's meaningful, frankly. And I think a lot of the opportunities in my context are affordances of new infrastructures. So to ask what's the opportunity outside of technology would be kind of nonsensical, you know, like, well, there might be a world like that, but it isn't this one, not the one I'm working in. So for example, well, let me just finish answering. So for example, the new infrastructures raise people's expectations about the kind of coordination they should be able to do and the kind of awareness they should be able to have about what's going on in the community and working together. But these are socio-technical affordances. So, you know, you have to take the whole package.
Okay. All I meant was that, you know, there are certain things that are engineered into Facebook, into sort of like, you know, that sort of change the way that we interact. There are certain sort of things that are engineered into Twitter, into email, into sort of SMS, into mobile phones. It seemed to me that some of the discussion sort of was thinking about these differences as sort of being, as determining the behaviors, as opposed to some combination of these and sort of like, you know, the context in which they are being used. And so I was encouraging sort of like, you know, more about sort of like, you know, the context or the sociology of like, you know, the sort of the community that you want this third space to sort of like, you know, actually be used in, and what we knew about the interplay between that and the details of the specific technology.
When you first asked the question, what came to mind was Bruce Maslisch's idea of coevolution. So the technology evolves with the social environment and even the individuals. That there is it's not static, it evolves over time and they both change. Now, I'm not talking as a designer, but I think that happens with design, particularly in today's world of perpetual beta, where it continually if this isn't working, you change it. So it seems to me there is a tension, but it's a creative tension, and both are changing. The sociology of the environment is changing, and the technology is changing. And you don't say that one is causing the other, they are co-evolving.
I think that's why we have to revisit these issues periodically, because we're in a completely different world than we were 20 years ago. So that was a point I tried to make about the history of community technology. It's a 41-year history in North America, but the questions people were asking 41 years ago don't make any sense today.
Well, and I like to frame these questions, keeping them goal-oriented. So the goal is increasing community engagement towards helping communities achieve common social goods. Technology is one factor that can help achieve those goals. It's a mediating variable, and there are also other sort of social, informational, geographical factors that are very important, as Aunt Andrea had summarized. And these things can then interact with each other, towards achieving these common goals. But as technologists, you know, of course, we naturally are prone towards thinking in terms of technological solutions, but they are co-evolving with these other more social social variables as well. I think a really good example is from our research that we've done recently. By going out and actually interviewing in neighborhoods and really trying to understand, like, when is a neighborhood successful? When is there a successful neighborhood community? And actually, it's really small or more urban or suburban environments. Face-to-face interactions are so important still. Very important factor in determining community well-being. And so when we're thinking about a technological solution to help increase community well-being, we should be thinking about technological solutions that increase face-to-face interactions, right? And so, like, it's and also thinking about things like another important predictor of community well-being was that there's a community organizer. There's somebody who's taken on that role of helping that community organize. It's an information broker, a trust broker, cat herder, whatever you want to call that person. And so how do you provide that person with the right tools to engage in those community engaging activities? So should we another question? Yeah?
I think this has just been such an important panel. There were some things that have been said that I think, you know, we really need to concentrate on more. I think Jack is right. You know, deliberation is one thing, and, you know, the thing I'm talking about is, you know, much less complete than that. It's conversation. And, you know, I wonder just how good of a job we've ever done about encouraging conversation online. Community informatics, to start with, I was fairly critical early on because community informatics was about information. It was about sharing information and building technologies to share information, not conversation. It was never about communication, really. It was always about providing sources of information to better access things. And that had a lot of value, but I think it missed that important step. And I think, you know, I forget who made the comment, it might have been Andrea, that, you know, social media is about affirmation. It's not actually about conversation. I think that's hugely revealing. And, you know, it does speak a little bit to, you know, why some of our kind of latest generation of community technology tools for local interaction may not be working in the way that we anticipated. I think about, you know, iNeighbors, which is a site I've been running for, you know, far too many years now, and it lives off, you know, neighborhood discussion email lists at the local level. And, you know, we haven't spent a lot of time updating it, and we get a lot of critique for that. It's just about email, but we still deliver a million emails a month between neighbors, and it's probably because people are willing to have a conversation on email, but they're not necessarily willing to have that conversation on Facebook. And I don't know why that is. Is it, you know, something about the experience of social media use that, you know, just puts you in a mode of it's about affirmation? Is it a fear of, you know, having information shared across different contexts that wouldn't happen necessarily as easily through email? What is it that is that problem? And I think our biggest design problem in the future is how do we design for cross-cutting communication that doesn't shut down the conversation? And I think it's much, much harder to do than we've ever realized.
So we have just a minute or two left. Maybe we should end with some final comments, perhaps more aspirational. Like, what might we, as far as like design recommendations, you know, what would you recommend if you're a crowd of technologists? If you're interested in this space, what do you recommend that we focus our next efforts on?
Okay. Well, I'm kind of restating my position paper, but I am very optimistic. I'm more optimistic than I've been in 20 years since I first got into this field. I think that there are possibilities now that weren't there before, and as we were saying a minute ago, I think it is a socio-technical evolution, but, you know, that doesn't, it's not just going to happen, so there's a lot to do, but I think it's worth doing, and I think there's a lot of possibility for researchers and technologists in particular.
Yeah, I was, I'll just reiterate or restate what I was trying to say at the end of my talk, just that how important it is for, to expect the technology to do the hard work and not the users, and that it's our job to improve the technology that would, in fact, find where people are having conversations and where people are talking, even if it's not deliberation, and they're sharing and then they're exchanging and they're making awareness greater and so on, and to integrate those rather than tell them to, you know, use this particular platform and, you know, you put, you know, your comments here and you put your photos over there. And so the kind of tools that do more of this discovering and integrating common topics or common interests and so on across a community that has an ecology of information sources and offline, online, many different devices and tools and so on.
So I would say that one of the things that I think as a technologist that we should be looking at are alternative fora that are effective. And I mean, we've heard that here as well, and it's something that we see. I mean, people in India are flocking to Facebook, but they are not using it as any kind of community kind of thing. It's what it's for here. I mean, they're swapping pictures, and they're, you know, teenage boys are trying to get together with girls, and that's really what it's about. But there are other fora that I think are better used, and we've heard that here as well. And I think it would be a shame if we don't really explore that. I mean, CGNet Swara, it was explicitly designed as one of these kind of forums and championed by tirelessly by this guy Xu to make it really work effectively. And I think understanding how those kinds of things work and then building to that end is actually a really fruitful and useful thing to explore.
I don't have too much to add. I would just echo this. I think the designers, whether we are all designers in some ways, I'd like to see us think beyond the individual impact and what it's going to do for a group or for a community. Having that in mind, as Shelley has said, you know, we've designed for different things in the past, so maybe it's time to look at the individual, the group, and the community level separately, but be aware of it in the design. Every design decision is a political decision, or if you will, a policy decision. And being aware of that, I think, is important.
Okay, great. Well, thank you all so much for participating in our panel, and thank you all for being here and participating in our conversation. We'll be up here if you have any other questions, you can come and ask. Also, the Design Expo, which is next door, my manager, Lily Chang, wanted to remind you all it's going on for another hour, so if you want to catch the end of it, you can do that as well. Thank you very much.